So not only is Fiona an iconic rescuer and treater of people who've been devastated by burns, not only is she a top clinician who wants to work right from basic science through to better outcomes, but she is also an inventor and a person of unique capabilities. So Fiona, I'd like to welcome you to give your talk on striving for excellence. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for such a kind introduction, and I'm not sure how I can live up to that, but I have to sort of give it my best shot. Because I wanted to really explore this whole concept of how we can strive for excellence and how we actually look beyond our own silo, beyond our own training, and connect into our communities to really look at how we can improve the quality of what we do individually, and also use the example of in burns care to illustrate those points, because that's where I live. That's what I do. I am primarily a surgeon. I'm a burns surgeon who, if you meet me professionally, you're not having a good day. And I see suffering every day. And it has been my life's goal to reduce that suffering. We have made progress, absolutely. Have we got to the end game? Absolutely not. There's an enormous amount of work left to do. And so it's with that I kind of try and bring this whole concept. If we want to improve something, we have to think about where can we find the information? How can we define the problem? And how can we focus into the future? I'll declare right up the front, as you've heard, what Maurice Stoner and myself invented what is called now the RECELL kit. We actually commercialized it, the two of us, a scientist and a clinician. All those years ago, in about 2002, we had this brainwave. Science, for those of you, you all know that science funding is hard. We thought what we were doing was unique and different, and I'll explain why. And therefore, we could assign our intellectual property into a foundation which would license the ability to commercialize into a company, and we would be able to fund our research with the royalties. That is a really naive 1 minute description of something that became one of the hardest challenges that we ever faced, but did bear fruit eventually, and is just now being taken up by the Armed Forces Institute of Regenerative Medicine in the USA and being put through FDA trials. But that's 20 years in the making. So, you know, don't hold your breath. And I'd like to point out, though, I declare this conflict of interest. Both Marie and myself's aim was to fund the research, and we have no personal gain from that, those royalties, and from any of the work going forward with respect to RECELL. So where do we start? And I'd like to, as I say, use burns as an example. A few years ago, the Medical Journal of Australia asked if I could write 100 words in a celebratory 50-year anniversary edition what I thought burns would be like, burns care would be like in 50 years. And these are the 100 words. And there was a whole spectrum of clinicians did this, but these are the 100 I wrote. And I'd like to sort of let you imagine a little bit what's behind this. And I want you to think of a car wash. And in the first part of this car wash is assessment. I want to know exactly what is wrong. I want to be able to look at it with my eyes, with the microscope, with my genetic analysis, and all the way up, and say, what is exactly wrong? What is the capacity of this person to heal from this injury? That's my assessment. There are many things already. Multimodal, multi-scale characterization, confocal microscopy, synchrotron technology, all focused on assessment. Yes, we could do a lot of those things already. We just need to miniaturize a few of them. And then the next part of the car wash is debridement. What I do on a daily basis is I remove burn tissue. The burn tissue is toxic. It is what drives all the secondary problems. If we leave it there, the risk of infection builds as each day goes by. And sometimes the outcome is fatal. So we know we are in a race against time to remove that burned tissue. And that's called debridement. And we take a sharp knife and we cut serially down until the patient bleeds. They are under general anaesthetic, of course. And that is not subtle. That is I know if that is bleeding, then that tissue is alive. That is not subtle. That maggots have in their saliva enzymes that can tell the difference between tissue that's dead and tissue that's alive. And in France, they have this kind of maggot tea bags. Be careful, drink coffee in France, by the way. And so if you put this maggot tea bag on your wound, it will elements of their saliva, I'm not sure it is saliva in maggots, but anyway, from one end, it dissolves the collagen so you can wipe off what is necrotic and you have a viable living wound underneath. If maggots can do it, why can't we? That is the second part of my car wash. And then we've come through into the third part of the car wash called reconstruction. So if you imagine, I've put the soap on, I've washed it all off, and now I'm coming into the reconstruction phase where I want to rebuild. And so I talk a lot about Darth Vader cuts off Luke Skywalker's arm. They build a new one. It is bad parenting, you'd have to say. But they build a new one and it works even better. Technology that is coming. Technology that's here in some place, in some aspects. But when the stormtroopers blow him away, then they put him in a back-to-tank. And this is what I want. I want a back-to-tank. I want people to lay there sleeping and comfortable, because we all know what burns pain is like. And I want them to come out like new. I just want a back-to-tank. And so when we look at this tissue guide regeneration with self-assembly of nanoparticles forming a scaffold such that when the cells grow into it, they express themselves for the right tissue, whether it be heart, liver, lungs, and in my case, skin. Oh, and then I wake up. Some of those things are here, but not all. And this is what we really need. To solve this clinical problem, we need a multidisciplinary team with a rigorous scientific approach. We need to translate all this energy, all this, I've got a great day here today, seeing amazing science, translate that into difference of the individual on the day when their life's gone pear-shaped. That's what we need. So, this is my dream, regeneration. And if lizards can grow a tail, then we should be thinking about it. And skin, I just lock the doors right now and you're not going to be let out of here for a week, because I could talk a leg off a donkey when it comes to skin. You know, eyes do colour, black and white. Skin does so many more things than when I was at medical school. It's crazy. And I'm sure the more we look, the more we will find. It is a multifactorial thing. It's more than just keeping your body in. It does an awful lot more. It interacts with our environment. It's continually feeding back to the brain and to all the other organs what is it that's out there. It is powerfully regenerative. As you sit there, I always think we should all be quiet and hold hands. We might hear it regenerating. You know, we replace our surface every 6 to 8 weeks. That's a powerful regenerative organ, but it doesn't take much for an injury to go through, and then that capacity for regeneration is gone and scarring takes over. And as I will show you, scarring is more than skin deep. So then when we start to think about, well, what if you're trying to do something and do something better, and I was faced, as a medical student, I went to London to medical school. I was absolutely obsessed with surgery because I was obsessed with anatomy. The human, I couldn't begin to describe how I felt when I went into the anatomy dissector room day one at medical school and saw the workings of the forearm on the inside. It was exquisite. In my head, it still is. The human body is exquisite, and if a surgeon puts that back together, I'm in. That was about my insight at that time. And so I wanted to be a surgeon, and I wanted to be able to understand what kind of surgery I was going to get involved in. And I understood that I needed a CV that would give me an opportunity for employment. I was one of 12 women in my year, and I was told that surgery was not a career option. So I thought, well, obviously a person to avoid, I'll go find someone else. And so I did a lot of research, and starting right from the word go. And the people that were doing really interesting things at the time were plastic surgeons. They still are. It's an innovative specialty. We work on a whole spectrum, extreme makeover, extreme rebuild. I work on the extreme rebuild end of the spectrum. We use a lot of the similar techniques. More recently, there's a new laser technique that's come out again out of the American military and the returned servicemen that's changed the game in trying to unscar scars. Work that we've started in Western Australia that is game-changing, when we've now started to look at the epigenetics of that scar change, that we can then feed back to the rest of our colleagues internationally and say, well, this is work that will then optimise that technology. So we work on the whole spectrum, and for me, it was the extreme rebuild and the extreme rebuild required by burn injury. For whatever reason, burns relate is associated with much more aggressive scarring than any other injury. So we get to, okay, well, where do you start? And we hear this, oh, well, this is the standard of care. This is the gold standard. This is where we aim. And I've put to you that the gold standard in my environment was split thickness skin graft. That is a shave off the top of your skin, take it from there, put it here. Leaves a scar there, often, always leaves a scar where you put it. I have done so many thousands of skin grafts, it makes me feel old. At 56, I kicked in as a consultant surgeon at 32. I have done a lot of skin grafts. I've left a lot of scars. So the gold standard can't be that, because I've achieved it every time. The gold standard has to be their skin at that body site at that time of their life. That's the gold standard. And I think in anything, it's really interesting to me. I see people think, oh, the gold standard is this, that, or the other. Well, if the gold standard is set at it, if you set the bar where you can jump over it every time, what are you bothering with? No point getting up in the morning to be average. Set the bar and strive. And I think just understanding that, just lifting our eyes just a little bit, gives us that energy to connect with people who are thinking the same, and it starts to lift the game. So gold standard for me is something that should be nothing less than perfection. If we accept less, we will get less. If we drive for the top, sure, we may come in lower, but we'll never stop trying. Regenerative medicine is what I'm really going to talk about in this whole context, because regenerative medicine is really the whole concept of bringing back the tissues to what it was in a functional way, not allowing the scarring process to take hold. But then there may be a very good reason why we don't actually regenerate. You know, we don't want to just be shedding limbs left and right. Oh, don't worry, I can grow another one. We want to actually think about the understanding of the science, understanding the science across the whole phylogenetic, from worms to elephants. I did work I was talking about, reminding myself earlier, when I was a med student, I did an extra degree and looked at comparative brain anatomy from worms to elephants. Now, I should get out more. But it was fascinating stuff. And so then, within that regenerative medicine, how are we going to drive this regenerative medicine? Where is the engine? We are made up of a clump of cells. That's how we start. And those cells divide, 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 and it's a blob, and then it becomes a blob that looks a bit like a different kind of shaped blob, and eventually it becomes recognizable as a fetus, and then it becomes a person, and then we are recognizable through life. We self-organize and we replace and retain that shape. We age, of course, but we are recognisable through life, driven by the engines within us, the cells. So can we use these cells as the engines to drive regeneration as opposed to scarring? And in doing so, we have to understand the problem. I think that you have to understand what your patient needs. What is the problem you're trying to solve? And how can you bring your experience and your environment of operation together to deliver the best possible outcome? But the beginning of the story is with using cells, skin cells harvested from you back to you. So, but before we can even use that, you have to look back, you have to look at everything. We spend a lot of time in teaching first aid and teaching primary principles, airway, breathing, circulation. We don't get off the blocks unless we have somebody who is stable and alive. And then we drive forward with that. I really focusing on the healing. And so meticulous attention to detail across the board. There is no excuse for anything else. We use what we know. And I think this is something that's a very simple thing like that. Meticulous attention to detail. Attention to detail. Day in, day out. Hour in, hour out. Minute in, minute out. Is there something you could do better? Is there a bandage you could put on better? Control the swelling better? There's so many lessons you can learn and translate into better outcomes the next day. Sounds simple. Challenging on a daily basis. Use what we know. Sounds simple. We work in a system of health where we have a very challenging evidence base. There's a lack of solid scientific evidence in a lot of things we do. We think we know, we use what we know, but do we really know it? If somebody tells you something, do you believe it? Or do you go and look it up? These days it's easy, but then you get all this white noise and this Wikipedia stuff. By the way, my birthday's wrong on there, but anyway. So you know, it's not that easy. Using what we know isn't that easy. Belief and fact are not the same thing. I tell the young registrars as they're going to their exams and they've got the old crusty consultants there like me and they're going to be rigorously examined and questioned. And I said, you have to understand there's no such thing as fact, it's only opinion, and you have to deliver your opinion so that it stands up to criticism. So even that simple statement, using what we know, yeah, next. Think about what it is that we know. And then that gives us a very solid platform to think about, right, we can make this better. We can optimise what we do, and then we push the boundaries, and that's when it gets exciting, pushing the boundaries. We don't have to be constrained by, well, it's never been done before, or, you know, we have to think about how can we do it better. And so when we first started, I'd like to tell you a story about a patient I met as a young doctor in 1990. I was a registrar at the time, rotating through the hospitals in Western Australia. I was interested in a career in burns, and so I took a great deal of interest in a lady, a 56-year-old with a 70% burn. I was rotated at the other hospital, but came in for teaching on a weekly basis. And 5 months after her burn injury, she was in ventilated in intensive care, sliding through our fingers like sand as the waves of infection came over relentlessly. And she was weakening. On my way down the Wellington Street between the two hospitals, if you know Perth, between the Children's Hospital and the Adult Hospital, I heard a radio station. Joanne Padlanetsky, a scientist in Monash in Melbourne, under the support of Professor John Masterton, the chief of the Burns Unit in the Alfred at that time, had gone to Boston and learnt how to grow skin cells. I almost crashed multiple pile-up. Where's the nearest phone? I've got to ring them. Cut a very long story short, and one of the administrators, who's a great friend of mine now, recently said in a talk that despite me asking whether this could be done and him saying no, I just didn't hear it. We took the last little piece of skin from the upper arm of this lady. It went with Ansett. That was an airline for the youngsters amongst the room. We didn't walk across the Nullarbor. And to Melbourne, they grew the cells into sheets. It took 3 weeks. They came back. We put the skin cell sheets across all of the wounds. She healed. She came off the ventilators and she was in the burns unit. At 7 months post-injury, she had a sudden cardiac arrest. Her heart stopped. We couldn't resuscitate her. Her heart had an fungal infection that had gone unnoticed, because her skin had been in a position where it couldn't protect her for all those months. Not many months later, in fact, January of 1991, on Friday I was registrar, and on Monday I was the director of the Burns Service of Western Australia. I was the only applicant, so anything alternative would have been a real embarrassment. And so I was hit the ground running. I was obsessed with time. I was obsessed with what can I learn out of this? That life cannot be in vain. There has to be learnings. And time to healing was absolutely barn door obvious. If she had healed sooner than that time, would she have been had an opportunity of survival? I know all these years later is the answer is absolutely categorically yes. Her life has changed the lives of many others. But time to healing. I wasn't satisfied with a 3-week time period. You burnt yourself with an iron. You burnt yourself, you know, with a cup of hot tea or something. Imagine half your body. One day in the burns unit is a day too long. So when we were the first 12 cases, we sent skin to Melbourne. They grew it there and then sent it back. And I processed it during the night time in the laboratory with, where they did the bone marrow harvest with Marie Stoner. So I met an equally nut sort of crazy person who was working through the night. And I met Marie and we got talking. And so in February of 1993, we had a telethon grant and we established the skin service laboratory in Western Australia together in the Children's Hospital. It was a great day. We put on the floor of this very small office everything that had been written about growing skin. It barely covered the floor. You'd fill the room now. You know, it was, what do they all do quick? What is the fast steps here? How can we add to that? Because I said to Marie, if a burn heals in 10 days, the risk of scarring is 4%, 21 days, 73%. Why wait? The risks increase. We need to move faster than 3 weeks. 10 days or I'm not interested. Not being pushy at all. And so she was she did the clever science. I did like, if I take the biopsy in the first couple of hours and I take it thin, then it doesn't need an overnight soak in the enzyme, only an hour. I've saved a day. Match that. And she did the science behind it, the science of understanding how we could harvest this and manipulate the enzymes we were using to get a rapid split, because the skin's in layers. Epidermal waterproof layer and the dermis, and it's stuck together by the engine room, the cells that grow. So we can peel that butter sandwich, the bread and butter sandwich, and what we want is the butter. That's the engine room, and that's what makes this grow, this epidermis grow. We noticed that when the cell sheets were fragile and holy, the patient's wounds looked better. We did a whole lot of experiments about looking at what's on the surface, all these little hairy bits, and how they stick and march across the surface of the wound. And so, before long, Marie was saying, well, I can do this in 10 days. I can do this in 7. And I came out of the operating room where we operate in at 34 degrees because our patients need to, you can't control your temperature anymore because your skin is a vital aspect of controlling your temperature. And if your core temperature falls, then your blood doesn't clot and it doesn't stay in. And it's much better in than out. Okay? So we have to work in a very warm environment. So I came out of the sweat box. I spent a few hours there. And I walk into the lab and there's Marie, very calm and cool under the beautiful in air-conditioned environment. I go, oh, we should just spray this stuff on. So we ran to this pharmacy and the anesthetic machine, and we took every nozzle that we could find, a hairspray, throat spray, nose spray, airbrushing, you name it. This comes from an Italian mouthwash. It's vortex in an aperture, means that 90% viability coming through the system. It's, you can see, it fits onto a normal syringe with no dead space. We didn't waste anything. Just suck it up, spray it on. And so that's where we started. And by now, she says, are you ready? It's 5 days. We can get this ready in 5 days. So we've come tumbling down the time scale. And I was struggling to get people ready for the 5-day time frame. And this is a young boy who had an extensive burn, who required a serial repair. He has his arms need releasing to allow the swelling. His skin needs removing and replacing with a framework. This is an integrodermal framework, an amazing construct. That's been actually all the research was in MIT in Boston, a collagen and glycosaminoglycans framework. If the pore size is 60 microns or over 100, it doesn't work. Pore size of 80 microns, the cells go, oh, we'll behave like dermis, we'll behave like skin. And it's tissue-guided regeneration. But it's hard for the first 3 weeks. You sit there on hot coals because there's no antibacterial properties at all. So infection is a real problem. And then you replace the surface with our mesh skin and our spray-on skin cells over the top. But where to then? We've started to put in the cells from this kit. And so what's this? This is the next step of the whole phase. I told you we got it down to 5 days. But then we noticed that our patients with smaller skin grafts, the skin grafts I told you about, were scarring worse than the ones that were bigger burns that we were using the neurotechnology on, in a life-saving sense. And so when we started to think about that, we thought, well, can we actually put the laboratory in a box? The basic aspects of the tissue engineering process in a box, take that box to the bedside in the operating room, and use the body as a tissue culture environment. Meticulous attention to detail. Any bleeding, any bacteria, any tissue left, it will not work. And the answer is yes. Now, takes 30 minutes. And we're at the bedside. We're at the bedside, and so we have total control, and we can do the operation when it is best for that person. We don't have to wait for a laboratory process. We don't have to spend the funds, which is a laboratory at this level is very costly. It has to have checks and balances so that those cells going from you back to you are you. Seems easy. Not that easy. And that there's no contamination along the way. So we were able to reduce the risks, reduce the costs, improve what we were able to do by taking this step. And then we were able to put these cells underneath this Integra construct, this amazing framework. And when we heal from a graze, we heal from the hair follicles up over the surface and from the cells coming in from the edge. So we thought, well, can we replicate that by putting these guys underneath here? And you can see they've migrated through and created new skin. But do we do this in everyone? And this is really challenging because I told you a lot of burns will heal. And if a burn heals in 10 days, there's a 4% risk of scarring. But how do we tell who's going to heal and who isn't? This is a child I met in 1985, and I've kept this photograph with me ever since. A cup of coffee, a hot drink caused this. And when I said that I'll show you that scar is more than skin deep, this child will never move that shoulder or neck normally, despite all the plastic surgery reconstruction that we would do. So how do we stop that? And how do we turn back time? I also told you that the split thickness skin graft is the gold standard. And it leaves a scar every time, and occasionally leaves a scar where we take it from. That is a scar I left when I harvested that skin graft to put on that boy's knee in 1996. Another picture I've kept with me all this time to remind me. We've got to do no harm. So, when we get to back to this whole question, in our area, we know we need the skin sealing. We know that the waterproof seal will save lives. We know we need the scaffold to give the toughness, the wear and tear. We know we needed to do better. We needed to change, paradigm shift, throw out the gold standard. So we took the skin from the sheets to the suspension to the bedside. That is 15 years of my life, less than 30 seconds. And so we were able to see that these cells are the engine room that can heal. But can we put them in an area that can then change this scar paradigm? I've shown you what we do in somebody who will not survive unless we replace that skin. We have no choice. But what about this boy? If we left him, he'd heal. But he'd heal with that deformity. How can we change the risk profile so that we can actually do an operation, but not leave the scar like I showed you on the bottom, and actually move the goalposts, push it towards regeneration, away from scarring. How do we do that? We have to understand the diagnosis. We have to understand what the problem is. We have to look at this multi-level and look at it all the way through to the cells and the capacity of the cells to heal. We have to understand the therapeutic opportunity of these cells, even if we don't understand what they're doing. And then we have to think about the changes we need in order to implement it. So, sorry, this is the cells. In the tissue culture flask, they don't work if they don't stick to these dead, because they're irradiated, fibroblasts. This is the cell that makes up your dermis. So we can get the epidermal cells to stick on dead fibroblasts in the tissue culture flask. Can we get them to stick on the dermis that we leave behind without taking it away, without risking moving backwards? If we've got somebody that we're going to heal and we start to remove that tissue, cut it away until it bleeds, then am I doing harm? Or can I put the cell, just clean the surface aggressively and put the cells on the top? And if I can get them to stick in the laboratory, can I get them to stick on a person? They're their cells, they're from you to you. So we change our paradigm. Salvage, salvage, salvage. And so we start looking at the science behind this. We can use a whole raft of different things, different pathways. These are proteins that would change pathways and allows things to heal. This is different healing rate. They're both going to heal, but some will heal quicker. Is this important? Yes. We can take certain different pathways. This is programmed cell death. Our cells are programmed to die. Our cells are programmed to shed off. How can we use this information so we can change that paradigm and use and introduce the cells from an area that's not injured into an area that's injured and shift the balance? And I'm going to tell you now, in 30 seconds, every one of you in this room will be able to do that. This is fancy science. It's an example of a lot of things that we do. I work with, I should have said right at the front, I'm team leader because I'm surgeon, but I have the privilege of working with great scientists in basic science, population health, clinical research, and as a team, we're able to cut across boundaries and solve clinical problems, harness that energy, and now you're going to be part of that, every single one of you. Because I know that if you go this weekend and you see a young child pull a cup of coffee down their chest, first thing is you remove the clothes. If the skin comes with it, it was always going to, you have done no harm. You are left with a very distressed child in a distressful environment. You will cool that wound. Clean, cool running water, 15 to 18 degrees for 20 minutes will reduce that wound by 80% in a child's scald. No ice. Ice may numb it and feel comfortable, but you cause a cold damage on the heat damage and you will worsen it. So clean, cool running water, first aid, is maximally effective in scald injuries in children, and it's maximally effective within the first hour of injury. You all now can change this because you changed the collateral damage. The energy of heat over time gives you the first insult. Your body responds to it and your collateral damage starts. By removing that energy from the surface, that heat from the surface, you will reduce the collateral damage. You will reduce the scar worn for life. You will actually all be able to influence the health budget. In 2005, I was asked about this. I said, you know, we all need to think about this. We all need to think about taking personal responsibility for our health, our wellness, and our education. And they said, give us an example then. I said, right, that's your example. Because if you have a child that comes in and with no first aid, requires surgical intervention and reconstructive surgery at 16 in order to wear to go to the ball with the same kind of dress as her friends, it's a 1 to 20 cost ratio. That is in the health budget. That's not the human cost. And I can show you now, because we've got 20-odd years of data that shows this. And this is a national data that shows if you've done first aid, you will reduce your length of stay in hospital, and this is for top-end burns, all-comers, adults and children. You will reduce your length of stay in hospital. You will reduce your infection rate because you clean it. You decontaminate the surface. And you reduce your need for surgery. because you're heal. So everybody here can change the health budget, impact on human suffering, and change massive science. The programmed cell apoptotic pathways, the WNT pathways, and all these things that scientists talk about, and I look, yeah, I'm with you, maybe. All those things are changed because of clean, cool running water. We know this. It's actually a fact. I hang on to that one because there's not that many of them hanging around. Not many true facts. And so we're able to look at this situation when a motorbike explodes. 80% body surface area burn. We're able to take the burn. You can see the white dermis. There's some bleeding coming through here. Spray. This is a cut to allow him to breathe. So we know this is a serious burn for many reasons. And then we put the cells on, and there he is 3 weeks later. We can change the way we do things. We can cover bigger areas with smaller donor sites. So we have to get it from somewhere. We get it from a very thin donor site, which heals better and very rarely leaves a scar, because then it spends less time in the enzyme and we can get it on quicker. And so this is what we expect now with the child scald. We expect to change. We have changed the goalposts. 80% of our pediatric scalds do not have scars. The pediatric scalds that require hospitalisation that we would have operated on in a traditional sense in early 1990s don't have the scars. We have changed the paradigm to a regenerative healing pattern, but we can't deliver it every day. We don't know why. These cells won't give up their sort of mystery, you know. We've got so much more to learn. Because in 20% of our children, they still scar. So we've got to learn and from these cases and take it back into the others. We also know that the cells are different from different body sites. You wouldn't take a skin graft from the sole of your foot and put it on your forehead, because you would actually notice. Skin, I mean, like I say, close the doors, I could talk about skin all day. Why is it different on different body sites? It scars differently on different body sites. Scars on your shoulder and here, centrally, are really much more aggressive. Eyelids are hard to get eyelids to scar. Interesting. Just knowing that gives us a glimpse that we maybe can find out, just characterising the different epigenetic pattern, which I'll come to, maybe we'll be able to open the doors to what these cells are doing. And so in this case, a little one who's fallen into a hot coals, we can take skin from the sole of the foot and put it on the palm of the hand. But babies are bigger. Little feet, big hands. Little legs, big arms. But we don't need the whole of the sole of the foot. We only need a tiny bit. We make it into a spray and we spray it on. But it matches. The skin matches. So how do we get this? How do we get it there more frequently, more reliably? How do we mimic the cells? How do we deliver our cells in a way that we can continually deliver them? How can we deliver biological payload in a way that we can have a level of control? And this is just a snapshot of work we're looking at the moment, where you've got the wound, you've got our scaffold, and we put the biological payload, which could be cells or proteins, and they've got magnetic nanoparticles in them. And we stimulate the magnet release intermittently. And this isn't done in people yet, so that we can control the speed of healing. Because not all the things that come out of these cells are good guys. Some of them actually drive the inflammation and drive the scarring. So level of control matters. And why does this all matter? Why does it matter that you walk around with a scar? Burns and scarring, it's more than skin deep. In Western Australia, I'd like to share another patient story. I've told you that we need rigorous science around what we do. Yet again, I'm going off into an individual who's changed my life, my thinking. Because you never lose an opportunity to understand something. And this one child, an 8-year-old boy, who had an 80% body surface area burn, and we thought we'd done very well. He sent us pictures from his school camp, paddling, riding horses and the like. He died as an 11-year-old with a very rare cancer. All I could think of is, have we done something that has actually increased this boy's risk? By surviving this major burn, have we changed things? Have the burn factors in itself, this insult to your immune system, your bone marrow, is massive in a burn. Would he have no extra, no more oomph to survive the next bit? I don't know the answer to that yet, but I do know that after some serious nagging, in Western Australia they have great data linkage. Fiona Stanley was instrumental in changing the whole paradigm of how we treat people with folate supplements, and the incidence of spinal defects with spina bifida and cleft lip and palate and all that kind of stuff is falling away because we have folate in our supplements, based on a lot of good epidemiology and data linkage. So I figured that in West Australia they could answer this question for me. Is burns linked with cancer? Is surviving a burn linked with a lifelong risk of cancer? The answer is yes, but very small. It's not just cancer. We went and linked with Aberdeen and Manitoba to increase the data sets. Yes, there is a link, but it is small. But there's also a link with other things, other secondary things in your heart, your liver, your lungs, your nerves, all sorts of things, other injuries, infections. Surviving a burn changes your life expectancy. We need to know why. We have to understand that 96% of these burns were less than 20% body surface area. My leg is 18, so this is about 20%. My life, not a huge burn. We have to know that these numbers are very small, but could we have saved 59 lives if they didn't get burnt in the first place? I don't know the answer to that. But I do know that if your life expectancy as a 65-year-old in West Australia is 12 years. If you have survived a burn, it is 6. I don't know why. So I'd like to put this to you. I guess it's a part of trying to make people think differently. Scar isn't normal. It isn't normal. We all wear scars. We all wear scars on our outside, on our inside. It is a human phenomenon. We have all got scarring. It could be our heart after a heart attack. It could be a stroke, a brain in a stroke. It could be a burn. It could be a small cut. We all wear scars. It's our healing process. But don't underestimate the fact that it isn't normal. It isn't normal skin. It isn't normal heart, liver, lungs, or whatever it is. So, if it's not normal, why does our immune system accept it? I am not an immunologist, but I'm asking my immunology colleagues to investigate this. Does it change our surveillance such that we've got a long-term impact? Answers I can't give you today. There are some people in this room that are seriously a lot younger than me. Maybe you will find the answer to this. I'm not sure it'd be in my lifetime. We know that stress is associated with cell aging. Is the stress of a burn going to cause this problem? Again, we need to find out. We've started working with people who understand the epigenetics. This is understanding how the DNA within the cells express themselves and guide a cell down a certain pathway. And we know from our work where we take pieces of skin from the same place on the body of a young man, 18 to 38, and match it with a non-injured site, we can see the cells have a different pattern of methylation. So it's like the punctuation. They've got all these, your DNA, your genes, your words. And you've got this methylation pattern which gives you makes sense of the language. And this is different. It is different, and we can see that trace it back to different genes that are upregulated, downregulated, link it back to pathways. So we're trying to find out where to go to answer these questions. And this is more than burns, this is beyond. Is this an opportunity to look differently at some of our other problems around our health problems, around cancer and heart disease, etc., and around regeneration, around the cells being the engines to drive healing? And so as I sort of try and having gone through a lot of information, try and bring that together. What is it that we need to heal? I'd rather have a scar than not be healed. We see many people suffer terribly from chronic wounds for year in, year out. I'd rather have a scar than that. But we have to understand we've got to the cells, and I've told you a bit of the cell story. We have to have frameworks so the cells feel comfortable and express themselves for the appropriate type of tissue. But we are self-organizing. We organize to this shape. What keeps us our shape? What keeps us recognizable through life? And can we use that information of self-organization to drive this scar to a normal healing, normal skin pattern? So this is work where we've looked at this density of nerves. This is a graph showing the red and blue dots and matched dots. This is everybody on this graph as at least 2 years post-injury. We've got a whole range of injuries from small injuries through to massive injuries in terms of your body surface area involved. And we're measuring nerve density. And you can see the nerve density falls away in that scarring. But look, our red dots and our blue dots are matching together. They march together. So in our skin that is not burnt, our nerves are damaged. And if we have an 80% body surface area burn, they're damaged more than a 20%. Why? Is the nervous system the driver to all this? On our brain, we have a patterning, and it relates to the extent of our nerves in our surface. So my hand, I touch my hand, I'll stimulate. If I buzz this here, my hand, I can make my hand move. If I buzz it here, I can feel it here. Just in front of, just that strip here. Before we did this to any of our patients, this is using transcranial magnetic stimulation, I did it. I went into the lab and they put the electrodes on me and tried to make my hand move. I had a tooth out the day before. Do you notice how close the face is with the hand? And how big my hand is? Because I do a lot with my hands. My forearms I don't do much with. So the hands are big. And my face is going, I'm like in a gurning competition, like I'm in a face-pulling competition. Like this. And they know I'm a bit nuts anyway, I suppose. But and they're just looking at me and turning up the dials. It's like, hold up, back up the truck. Because I think we need to think about doing the other side. So in 24 hours, pain has swamped it. How do we understand the plasticity of our central nervous system and bring back that patterning by stimulating the wound in a healing phase so we normalize our pattern, and our normalizing our pattern here drives a normal shape there. Gosh, I wake up again. Yeah, I'm dreaming. Because this is a pattern of a transcranial magnetic map of a young boy 4 years after he was burnt on a single upper limb. And this is somebody age and sex matched, his pattern, and this is where the limb is altered threshold to stimulation and an altered position. Can I use that to drive a normal shape? Can I use that to think myself whole? Can we unscar the scar? Can we, you know, if you have a phantom limb pain, if you have an amputated leg, and people scan your brain pattern of the missing leg is still there. But you could treat that. You can change that patterning. You can change that. That plasticity allows that patterning to change in some people. Can we change that patterning? This is a scar that we have changed by taking a piece of skin from behind the ear and sand and respray. We've dermabraded and resurfaced. We have not removed the scar, we have blended it, changed it, made it more acceptable. But how can we take it the next step? In order to do that, we need a lot of data. We need to understand our outcomes and we need to understand the injury. This injury is clearly much more severe than this. We have to have parameters of measurement of our injury, right back to the car wash. We have to have parameters that measure all the outcomes, all the way along the time frame, in order that we can understand what it is that we do at every stage and understand this whole journey and understand how we can do better. And to do that, we have to be working together. I've mentioned this along the way, that striving for excellence is something that I believe is the responsibility of everyone. I was given an opportunity in 2005 to travel the length and breadth of Australia. I still can't believe it happened to me. It's a very kind of a bubble that it was just extraordinary experience. And I spoke to loads of people, and it was just really fascinating to me to see how much good there is out there, how many good stories there are out there, and how many good things we just don't know about. And part of, I guess, going forward, I felt that we all really need to actually take responsibility for sharing good news stories. We're all good at telling the bad news. What about sharing good news stories? There's a truckload of good news stories here. How about sharing those good news stories so that we can connect with positive energy? And by connecting with that positive energy, we can strive forward. And we start to understand, but we need to take responsibility for our decisions. Not on a personal level, but on a societal level. Drive for a society dependent upon the integrity of each and every one of us rather than the intellect of a few. Understand the decisions we make have ramifications across the board so that we can change this whole seesaw with this health budget away from the preventable pathology into advancing technology so we can drive forward into the future. We are back at the front line. When my kids, this is a photograph that was taken at the time of the Bali bombing. Burn surgery is labour intensive at this point in time. We've got a lot of work to do. I think with robotic type stuff and enzymatic things and all things of the future. But right here, right now, it's labour intensive. We know for every 30 minutes on the operating table, it takes another 6 weeks to reach the plateau of outcomes. It's all hands on deck in a major injury, so we can actually do this surgery in a way that keeps the person alive and in the best condition. What's the evidence behind that? It's kind of like a little bit of the art and science. I said earlier that, you know, it's a little bit like, well, Jamie Oliver is a better cook than I am, but I'm sure I'm better at this than Jamie Oliver is. But what I want to do is I want to do a bit of a Hester Blumenthal. And I want this. I want to take my blinkers off. I want to see what's happening around in other areas. I want to see what I can apply to improve the quality of life for the people who I meet on a daily basis. The best thing about that is it's not mine. And so we need to understand how we can, I hope I've shown you, bring big population data, generate hypotheses, look at the mechanisms in basic science and change people's lives. But it's just skimming the surface. There's so much more to do. And I'm going to actually read this to you. Teamwork is what it's all about. Collaboration is what it's all about. It's about connecting with positive energy. Negative criticism without engagement in problem solving is a waste of everybody's time. You may as well walk on by. Go find somebody who wants to actually help in problem solving. And for me, Bali was a time in 2002 where I saw extraordinary things happening across the whole of the country. People doing things for others that they would never meet again and that they didn't know. All sorts of things. And so at 3 weeks when we had a mass exodus and a state of origin swap, you can have yours if I'll have mine, one of the nurses who'd known me for a very long time gave me these words from George Bernard Shaw, and I'm going to read them to you. This is the true joy of life, the being used for a purpose, the recognized by yourself as a mighty one, the being a force of nature rather than this feverish little clod of ailments and grievances complaining that the world will not devote itself to making you happy. I am of the opinion that my life belongs to the whole community, and as long as I live, it is my privilege to do for it whatever I can. I want to be thoroughly used up when I die, for the harder I work, the more I live. I rejoice for life in its own sake. Life is no brief candle to me. It's a sort of splendid torch which I've got a hold of for the moment, and I want to make it burn as brightly as possible before handing on to the future generations. Those words resonated at the time. They still resonate with me. I think as a surgeon, I find it a privilege on a daily basis when people give me consent to operate on them. I think if you think this is over the top, you should stand back and think about yourself and your motivations. I think if you think this is over the top, you should think about what people have done for you, how you could pay it forward. Because I really believe that there's no point in getting up in the morning to be average. You get up in the morning to be the best you can be. I think it's really interesting that I see that everyone is unique and special. Everybody's got a gift to give, and for me, I've been very fortunate that a lot of people have supported me for all the way from my childhood all the way through to the point I'm a surgeon, based on an education and training and support through years in, years out, the team that I work with now. Building that support, building the sort of rapport that goes with problem solving on a daily basis. No man is an island, and everybody is unique and special. Everybody's got a gift to give. We have to stand back and think, how can I help those around me realise their potential? And in doing so, how can I realise mine? And you don't have to go far to realise life is fragile and life is precious. And this is a picture taken on Australia Day of January of 2003. And every flare is for one of those young people who did not come home for their holiday in Bali. Thank you very much.